now let us come to some problem solving where we will be, at least I think that we are having fun, and I hope you will also seem so. We will be soon be looking at the exercises on property relations. So please open your exercise sheet on page 9. Exercises known as property relations, PR1 to PR14, out of which PR14 we will not discuss just now, that is, and I am giving you a advance warning that will be part of the final exercise at the end of the course. Not just that, its modifications. And now let us begin with PR1. It says consider S as a function of T and P. Show that TDS is something. This is absolutely a basic exercise, even basic than what we have. Before we do that, there are some preliminary stuff. For example, we must know how to manipulate and obtain Maxwell's relations. We should be comfortable with partial derivatives. Okay. And then for fluids, we have shown that CV, which is defined to be partial of u with respect to t at constant v, has been shown to be t partial of s with respect to t at constant v. Similarly, you should show and not hesitate to use this relation. Cp, which is defined to be partial of h with respect to t at constant p, is temperature into partial of s with respect to t at constant p. So wherever we see Cv or partial of u with respect to t at constant v, we should not hesitate to put it, and wherever we see Cp, we should not hesitate to put this. Now let us look at, it says consider S as a function of t and p. Okay, let us go to the next page so that everything is over in one page. This is PR1. We are told to consider S as a function of P and T, or T and P, okay, turn it around, doesn't matter. Let us consider S as a function of T and P, get partial of S with respect to t at constant p plus, sorry, into dt plus partial of s with respect to p at constant t dp. This is just expansion of S as a function of P and T. This is the differential of S. Now the moment you say partial of S with respect to T at constant P, it should remind you of Cp, but there is a factor T missing. So let us multiply this whole equation by T, and we will get TdS is T partial of S with respect to T at constant P dt plus T partial of S with respect to P at constant T dP. This we know, and I said we should not hesitate to replace that by Cp or Cp by that. Here we see this, so we will replace it by Cp. So this is C Cp dt plus, what about this? Again, let us open our Jacobian box. This is partial of S with respect to P at constant T. Partial of S with respect to P, the constant is T. So we have a TS in the numerator, replace that TS by PV. Ha, now we have VP, PT, P is on a diagonal. So that means this partial derivative, partial of S with respect to P at constant T, would be a derivative which is in which P is constant, but because that is on a diagonal, there is a negative sign, and partial of V with respect to T, partial of V with respect to T, okay, and then dP. So this we derive the first TdS relation. TdS is Cp dt minus T partial of V with respect to T at constant P dP. And again notice, if you want you can divide this by T. So you get ds is Cp by T dt minus partial of V with respect to T at constant P dP. Again you will notice that there is one term containing Cp which will require the knowledge of Cp, and another term containing just PVT data as we saw in case of the U. So when you integrate this, again you will have to integrate it along an isobar and then along an isotherm. When you integrate along the isobar, you will require the knowledge of Cp as a function of temperature at one pressure, but you will require the knowledge of the PVT data all over the state space, or at least over the required part of the state space. That takes care of PR1. PR2 says, consider S as a function of T and V and derive another expression for TdS similar to that in exercise 5.1. I will take a 5 minutes break, but meanwhile I would like all of you to show that follow this exercise. I will keep this slide here, but instead of S as a function of P and T, consider S as a function of T and V, but otherwise follow the same procedure and you should be able to show that this is Cv dt plus T partial of P with respect to T at constant V dV. Show that. And there are, these two are very famous equations. Usually these are known as the TdS equations. For some reason this is known as the first CdS equation, or the equation TdS equation based on pressure and TdS equation based on volume. The name itself is TdS relation. Tests are over, but anyway this was not a test, and I hope you have been able to derive this, and you have to follow essentially the same method, and you will notice the similarities between the first and second TdS relations. And I also recommend that when we derived this du, also it is recommended that you derive an expression for dh. It should be of the order of, here we considered everything to be a function of T and V. We considered u as a function of T and V. Consider h as a function of T and P. You can and obtain dh as a function of Cp dt plus something into dp. Okay. And this should be true for any fluid. And if you are interested, just substitute PVT data for an ideal gas here and show that whatever is in the square brackets is 0. And you should be able to show that this is very similar to the rectangular bracket here. P will be replaced by V, V will be replaced by P, and there will be some changes in signs, that is about it. Otherwise it should be very similar to that, because most of the relations are like that. Here also you would notice that between the first TDS and second TDS equation, wherever you have P, it is replaced by V, wherever it is V replaced by P. So P and V are interchanged, and sometimes there is a change in sign. Here there was a negative sign, here there is a positive sign. So let me do one more problem and then I will take up, I will begin the discussion session. The problem which I am going to take up is PR3. It says, using the results of exercises 5.1 and 5.2, show that Cp minus Cv is something, something, something. Now remember that these are the property relations for any simple compressible system or for a fluid. We know that for an ideal gas Cp by Cv is a constant R. For a general fluid it will not be so, and this is the expression. If you want to check, even before deriving this, check that if you substitute on the right hand side PV equals RT, you should get that thing to be equal to R. But let us first derive this, and for deriving this we must be using these two TDS relations. So we will rewrite those two TDS relations and we will see what we get. What I am going to do is, rather than rewrite the two TDS equations, I will equate the right hand side of the first TDS equation and the right hand side of the second TDS equation. So the right hand side of the first TDS equation is Cp dT minus T dP by dT at constant V dP. Let me check whether I have written that rightly. So it is dV by dT at constant P dP. dV by dT at constant P dP. Okay. The second TDS equation's right hand side, CV dT plus T partial of P with respect to T at constant V dV. Am I right? Yes. Now notice that we have a dT here on the left hand side and right hand side, and we have a dP here and we have a dV here. Let us rewrite this equation with dT on the left hand side and dP on dV on the right hand side. And finally, I want to consider T as a function of P and V. That is not the only choice. I am taking the choice where I want dT to be left hand side, dP and dV on the right hand side. You can select any one of dT, dP and dV to be on the left hand side and the other two on the right hand side. That means you can consider T as a function of P and V, or P as a function of T and V, or V as a function of P and T. The final result will be the same. I have decided to use this. So if I transpose terms containing dT on the left hand side and everything else on the right hand side, I will get the following, and divide throughout by the coefficient of dT, which will be Cp minus Cv, I will get this relation. dt equals t divided by cp minus cv into partial of v with respect to t at constant p dp plus t divided by cp minus cv partial of p with respect to t at constant v dv. From here to here, from equation 1 to equation 2 is only algebra. Now we use calculus. Notice that t, p, v are all properties. So this is our standard formula, d phi equals m dx plus n dy. D phi is equal to m dx plus n dy, and hence this m must be the partial of t with respect to p at constant v. So I get partial of t with respect to p at constant v equals t into cp minus cv partial of v with respect to t at constant v. And from the second part, partial of t with respect to v constant p must equal t divided by cp minus cv into partial of p with respect to t at constant v. Let us say these are equations 3 and 4. Just the way we had a choice here of selecting any one variables, one derivative, one differential, dp, dt or dv in one on the left hand side. Now we have a choice of either using equation 3 or equation 4. Let us take equation 3. Let me transpose this cp minus cv on the left hand side and the partial derivative on the left hand side to the right hand side. You will get cp minus cv equal to t partial of v with respect to t at constant p divided by partial of t with respect to p at constant v, and by the property of partial derivatives, whatever is in the denominator, effectively its reciprocal can be put in the numerator. So the numerator remains as it is, partial of v with respect to t at constant p, and the denominator gets inverted, partial of p with respect to t at constant v. And this is what we set out to prove. So we can say QED. And of course, we used equation 3 for this. You can check that even if you equation 4, use equation 4, you will reach the same result. So again you can write QED. And here I had made a choice of selecting t as a function of p and v. You can select p as a function of t and v or v as a function of t and p. Again, in any one of those two other things you will have a choice at this stage, but any of the choice, finally you will reach the same conclusion. Okay, so just check that, appreciate this. PR12, in a property table, three consecutive entries at constant pressure are as follows. Note what we have is, remember this is enthalpy, entropy. And they are at constant pressure. So at some constant pressure, you have these three points. May not be on a straight line. I think they are approximate straight line, but not exactly straight line. So let us say you have points 1, 2 and 3. you have to determine T2 and G2. So remember that since this is an isobar constant pressure, the variation of dH remember our basic property relation for dS is TdS plus VdP. And that means temperature is partial of H with respect to S at constant P. Temperature is partial of H with respect to S at constant P. So, partial of H with respect to S at constant P is the slope of the tangent here. And all that you have to do is say fit the parabola between 1, 2 and 3 and determine the temperature at 2 as the slope. Actually these 3 points have been taken from the steam tables, so but may not be this steam table, some steam table. And you can now determine the temperature, and since entropy is also known, H minus TS will give you the value of G. If you look at the variation in H is 65 to 86, 21 kilojoule per kilogram between 1 and 2 and 22 kilojoules per kilogram between 2 and 3. So if you approximately assume it equal, then the slope of this chord and the slope of the tangent here will be almost the same. So you can, a crude way, so recommended is fit a parabola, that is H equals A plus BS plus CS squared. Now these A, B, C 3 points can be determined by using the data at 1, 2, 3 and then determine the slope, whereas a crude approximation for T2 will be H3 minus H1 divided by S3 minus S1. So this will be 3508 minus 3465 divided by 8.329 minus, sorry, 8.384 minus 8.329. Units of H are kilojoule per kg, units of S are kilojoule per kgK. So this will cancel out, you will get your answer in Kelvin. I think that explains it. And now I am ready to take questions. Okay, let me go in order. There are 4 people already. NIT Trichy, are you ready with asking some questions on what happened today morning? Over to you.
Sir, in your PV diagram and TS diagram, you set in the reversible on both curve is shown in the diagrams are equal. So can we equate both area under the curve are equal so that the cyclic processes become zero, that du from the first law. Am I right? Over to you.
See, the question is about the PV diagram and the TS diagram. The question is about the PV diagram, TS diagram. It is only when you have a reversible cycle that the two areas are equal. When you have when you have a reversible process, in a reversible process which is not a cycle, dE may not be 0 or will not be 0 in general. So your heat interaction may not equal work interaction. Remember here, any process you have delta E equals Q minus W, and if you consider a fluid at rest, you have delta E equals Q minus W expansion minus W other. Okay. And even if you have all this plus reversible, all that happens is delta E is Q minus W, but W is then W expansion because W other cannot be there. It is only, but this delta E is not equal to 0. It is only when it is a cycle that you have 0 equals Q minus W. So this implies Q equals W. So that is why that reversible cycle for a fluid at rest is necessary. Over to you.
Sir, this is regarding the gaseous behavior. So we have this kind of Maxwell relations, the several equations have been derived for gases. Gas can also be considered as a fluids. For example, in fluid mechanics, we have several non-dimensional numbers comparing all the properties. So why don't we have a simple non-dimensional numbers instead of having this kind of complex equations? Over to you, sir.
You asked about dimensionless numbers. Okay, the dimensionless numbers are they are used in fluid mechanics, they are used in heat transfer and all that. Remember, those dimensionless numbers are essentially for with a transport phenomena. That means you have state plus transport properties. So take Reynolds number, you have a geometric factor, diameter, you have a velocity factor, which is the actual process dependent, which is the velocity. Then you have properties like rho and mu, out of which rho is a thermodynamic property, but mu, the dynamic viscosity, is not a thermodynamic property. Whereas in when you mention Maxwell's relation, Maxwell's relations are with variations. The only way you can make them dimensionless is perhaps by dividing them with appropriate numbers. As far as I know, the only dimensionless number or the most common dimensionless number used is what is known as, for some unfortunate reason, the compressibility factor, and that is for a state. It is defined as PV by RT for any fluid. Okay. So this is the compressibility factor, but if you want to take, for example, partial of S with respect to P at constant T, and you want to make it dimensionless, the only way to make it dimensionless is maybe you will have to divide P by something, say critical pressure. So I will write here, multiply this by P ref, and this will be by something delta S ref, and then you will have this I will call S plus as a dimensionless S, and then this will be dimensionless pressure or reduced pressure, and then constant. This is maintained constant, so there is no question of something like this. Artificially we will have to make them dimensionless, but that only will just add some numbers here. The basic characteristic of Maxwell's relations will not change and will not be simplified if you use dimensionless parameters. Over to you.
Thank you very much, sir. Over and out.
Thank you. KK Wag, Nashik, over to you.
Sir, how for a reversible process W other is equal to 0?
The question is, for a reversible process, how is W other equal to 0? Now remember that when you want a process to be reversible, it is needed that interactions take place, say whatever interactions take place from the initial state 1 to final state 2, they can be reversed when you come back from final state 2 to the initial state 1. And of course, the process has to be quasi-static. There are other requirements, but one requirement is, as you go from 1 to 2, whatever are the interactions, those interactions must be turned back, must occur in the other way by exact method, exact quantity. Now we have a fluid, and fluid has one mode, that is expansion compression mode, which is a two-way work mode and which gives us W expansion. It could be W compression also. In one way it will be expansion, another way it is compression. Okay. But if you have something like a stirrer, then you can stir the fluid, but the fluid cannot stir the stirrer. So this is a one-way mode of work. So if you have a stirrer work in the process, then it cannot be a reversible process. Hence, for a process to be reversible, there should not be any stirrer work or any other stirrer type of work. For example, electrical work for a fluid, remember, which is a simple substance. So there is a simple system. So there is only one mode of work, two-way work, that is expansion work. So for a reversible process, since there cannot be any other mode of work, for a reversible process for a fluid, W will be W expansion. I hope that explains it. Over to you.
Thank you, sir.
Mepko Sivakasi, over to you.
Sir, I asked one question during the coordinator's training program, that whether we can write CV from the TDS is equal to CV DT plus PDV. From that, whether I can write T into dou S by dou T at a constant volume is equal to CV. You told that no to that questions. But now you have derived one equations based on that type, that is DT during the derivation of CP minus CV. We have the relations DT is equal to T by CP minus CV, something like that. From that you have written dou T by dou P at a constant volume is equal to T by CP minus CV, dou V by dou T at a constant pressure. Similar equation you have written today.
I think what had happened during the coordinator's workshop and what has happened and what generally happens quite often is something like the following. People take shortcuts. For example, if you have, say, let me take du equals tds minus pdv. So from here, people simply divide by something, say divide by temperature. And the thought process goes like du by dt, ds by dt, dv by dt, and then you say, oh, let's put these as partial derivatives with something as constant. So then you will say, put something like this and convert these into partial derivatives. That is wrong. That is not what we want to do. If you want to get du by dt at constant p, then you should start with du equals tds minus pdv. Consider u as a function of T and P, because you want partial of u with respect to T at constant P. Consider S as a function of T and P. Consider V as a function of T and P. Expand du, ds and dv using the normal calculus, and then combine terms containing dp and combine terms containing dt together. Okay. So, quite often in case of simple situations, what you get by this and what you get by the proper method may be the same, but that is only accident. So, don't take those shortcuts. Don't, it is very dangerous to take mathematical shortcuts. We are not mathematicians, we are engineers. So, whatever mathematics we use, we will be use it on the straight and narrow track. We will not go off track. That is the domain of mathematics. Let them develop shortcuts for us, explain them properly, and then we will use them. One such shortcut we are using, the Jacobian formulation which we are using is one such shortcut. But mathematicians have developed it properly, made it available to us through standard textbooks, so we are using it. So my objection was not to your writing, say Cp equals T ds by dt at constant P, or its sister formula Cv equals T ds by dt at constant V. My objection was the, you know, the shortcut and quickie way by which this was obtained. Over to you.
So the equation ds is equal to Cv by T into dt plus P by T into dv is similar to this equation dt is equal to something into dp plus something into dv. For that you have used that dou t by dou p, that is which is similar to dz is equal to mdx plus mdy. This is also similar to that dz is equal to mdx plus mdy. Why don't we use for this?
Again, your question is the same thing. It looks similar, it may even be correct, but that is not the mathematically proper way to do it. See, we are, remember one thing, we are, for simplicity and because this is for undergraduate students, we are looking at systems which are inherently simple. Okay, that means one two-way work mode, we have only two properties. But the moment we go to complex systems, say for example a fluid which is electrically charged or even magnetically active like a plasma, okay, out there you will have not just two variables, but you have three or four variables which will be needed to define a state. And then our partial differential, partial derivatives will not be something like partial of T with respect to P at constant volume, but maybe partial of T with respect to P at constant volume, constant magnetic induction, constant electric field. And when you have such complications, taking such shortcuts is absolutely no-no. Over to you.
Sir, how do you write dou t by dou v at a constant volume is equal to T by Cp minus Cv into dou v by dou t at a constant pressure from that, from the equation dt is equal to something into dp plus something into dv? That is T by Cp minus Cv, dou p by dou v at a constant volume one side. The another side T by Cp minus Cv, dou V by dou T at a constant pressure dp. From that equations you have written dou T by dou P at a constant volume is equal to T by Cp minus Cv into dou V by dou T at a constant pressure. Only I applied that concept only. Over to you, sir.
No, I think you have missed some step. Our first TdS relation was TdS equal to Cp dt minus T dv by dt at constant P dp. This is the first TdS relation. The second TdS relation is Cv dt plus T dp by dt at constant V dv. This is the second TdS relation. Now, I think what I said something and which I think a few of you have missed out. All I do is, since the left hand sides are equal, and if the RHSs are equal, then I equate them. And now all I do is transpose this to the left hand side and this to the right hand side. And I am combining factors of dt together. On the right hand side, I will have t dv by dt at constant p dp plus t dp by dt at constant v dv. Now I am just multiplying everything left hand side and right hand side by 1 by Cp minus Cv. So in that case, this will get cancelled out. I will get Cp minus Cv here. I will get Cp minus Cv here. I am not dividing by any differential. I am not multiplying by any differential. This is very proper mathematics. And beyond this, it is just calculus of partial differential equations. Over to you.
So after this equation, how do you write the dou t by dou p at constant volume is equal to that that part t by Cp minus Cv to dou e by dou t at constant pressure? After this step,
consider this part to be m. Consider this part to be n. And then, so now I have dt equals mdp plus ndv. Compare this, this is equal to, by definition or by partial differentiation, v dp plus partial of t with respect to v at constant p dv. And just by comparison, now my dt by, say here, or if you want dt by dv, I will take dt by dv must equal n. So dt by dv at constant p must equal n, which by our previous slide is t by Cp minus Cv partial of p with respect to t at constant v. So that is t divided by Cp minus Cv partial of p with respect to t at constant v. Over to you.
So now you have the dt is equal to mdp plus ndv. So for my equations, ds is equal to Cv by t. So it means Cv by t will be m plus p by t into dv. P by t will be n here. So instead of dv, here also I am having dv. So instead of dt, I have ds. Instead of m, I have Cv by t. Instead of dp, I have dt. Instead of n, I have p by t. Then dv, I am also having dv. This is similar to these equations. Over to you, sir.
Professor, I suggest you write your argument down and mail it to me, because you are saying something and I don't know where the numerator and denominator is, and there is likely to be some confusion. Okay, so you write it down and mail it to me and I will take care of that. I think there is some issue, some misunderstanding between you and me. Over to you.
Thank you, sir.
So let's break for lunch and we will see you soon after lunch at 2 p.m. Thank you.